In this video, I'm going to attempt to put this Motorola phone into its hidden test and service modes. In the 1990s and early 2000s, Motorola phones had a unique way of accessing test modes. To demonstrate this, I have here a Motorola StarTAC. The StarTAC first came out in 1996, and there were many different models over several years. The one I have here is, I believe, a StarTAC 80 from 1997. One of the surprising things about the StarTAC that I have here is the SIM card that it takes. This phone uses the largest possible SIM card size. Despite there being at the time two different SIM card sizes, the mini SIM card that was being used by other manufacturers in many different models of phones several years before the StarTAC. But there was also the full-sized SIM card that Motorola had been using in their phones before the StarTAC came along. Then, when it came time to make the StarTAC, which was the smallest and lightest phone available in the world at the time, they continued to use the world's largest SIM card size. I mean, this phone is about the same size as the SIM card itself. It's actually quite a feat of engineering that Motorola were able to do this and make a phone this small and still have this huge SIM card slip so easily inside. Which brings us now to how test mode is activated in these Motorola phones. And it's done using a Motorola test card. These test cards have special codes on them, which, when inserted into a Motorola, will detect those codes and activate the hidden service functions inside the phone. This can then give you control over such things as activating the radio transmitter, you can unlock the phone, and you can run hardware diagnostics. I also have here another card from Motorola, and this is a transfer card. This card activates a different service mode inside the phone and enabled a copy of one phone to the other. When I put this card into the phone, it comes up in clone mode. Using the command 021 hash, it starts to make a copy of the address book and even all the user settings from the phone onto the card. Now you may have noticed I didn't start with demonstrating the test card, and that's because this test card doesn't work. It's either faulty, or more likely, this is not the original SIM card that came with this test card set. These were both given to me, so I'm not going to complain. And it's also okay, because in this video, I'm going to build a SIM card emulator. That will enable me to emulate the test SIM card and still put this Motorola into test mode. And even better, I'll be able to emulate a transfer card as well. That means when I copy memory from a Motorola phone onto the emulated transfer card, I'll actually have a copy of the memory from the phone saved onto my computer, which I can examine and even modify before loading it back into the phone. Because the transfer card copies entire sections of memory on the phone, I'll be able to do things you can't do with the original transfer card, such as activate hidden menus inside the phone. Let's have a quick look at this Motorola StarTAC. It has a really nice dot matrix LCD. It's got a fairly basic menu system, which was common for this period. I do want to see if I can activate one of the hidden menus using keypad codes. The code involves holding down the star button to bring up a pause symbol represented as a square. Three pauses. 001, pause, 1, pause, okay. 070, pause, pause, okay. Let's see if that has activated anything in the phone. I tried using these codes to activate the hidden engineering menu, but Motorola removed this ability from later firmware versions, which indicates that the firmware version in this StarTAC is just too new to use these codes. To get any further with messing about with this phone, I'm going to first need to build a dummy SIM card to serial port interface. I'll then be able to trick this StarTAC into thinking it has valid Motorola SIM cards inserted. The circuit I'm using to build this interface is fairly simple. It's just 3 transistors and 6 resistors. The hard part is I need a dummy SIM card that I can put inside the phone. To do that, I'm going to use this little SIM card adapter and modify it. But to modify this, the first thing I'm going to do is remove the micro SIM card slot from this adapter. I also have here a full-size SIM card. So I need to find a way to mount that right over the contacts. I'm soldering 4 wires onto it, which I can then run out of the phone and into the computer. I'm using some double-sided tape to hold everything down. Okay, that looks pretty good. It is a little bit thick where the wires are, but I don't think that will be a problem. I'm also using sticky tape to hold everything in place. One dummy SIM card. To build this adapter, I'm just going to solder everything directly to this serial port connector, using simple point-to-point soldering. It should be a simple enough circuit for me to be able to use this technique. Reset. Goes through a 10K to the transistor on pin 6. Okay, third collector. Got one collector, a 2 collector, third collector. Okay, that's it. It's finished. I now have a dummy SIM card to serial port adapter cable. This would have to be now one of the strangest cables in my collection. But then I found I'd created a huge problem for myself when it came time to plug this into the computer. It seems I hadn't even bothered to check that I was using the right connector when building this cable. I now have a massive problem because I built this using point-to-point soldering, all soldered directly onto the connector. So I went back to building, and instead of rebuilding everything, I found 2 more connectors and wired them together so that I could adapt my poorly built cable and finally connect it to the computer. And I did also double check all the connections and all the wiring, and it all looks pretty good, so I'm keen to give this a go. This gives me the perfect excuse to get out my Windows 98 Toshiba laptop, which I always really enjoy using. The software I'm using is a very old DOS program by the Android called ASIM. This is where I hit another big problem. ASIM won't run on this computer. I keep getting an error 200 every time I try to run it. After a bit of research, I find out that really old software compiled with old compilers can have problems running on computers faster than about 200 MHz because of issues with timing. Fortunately, I found there are ways to patch this problem and get this sort of older DOS software running on slightly faster computers. And with that, I now have ASIM running on my laptop and I'm ready to test my interface. The information I'm using in this video is mostly coming from the excellent Yanis Mott GSM pages. No relation, by the way. These pages can now only be found on the Internet Archive resource. Okay, ASIM is now finally running, so it's time to test this out. Time to get the new emulated SIM into the phone. Got to be a little bit careful because it is a bit fatter than a usual SIM card. That's not too bad. ASIM is running. Switch to full screen mode. Now, I need to load the test SIM configuration file. Emulator, run auto. Okay, the software should now be ready. Okay, that looks good. Let's get the card in. And there it goes. Okay, so the pin number that's been set up with ASIM is 5328. Okay. All right, pin verify okay. That looks good. That's actually working. All right, to access test mode, hold down hash. Yep, there it goes. We have test mode on the phone. All right. I can now input any of the dozens of Motorola test commands available. A good number of them are listed in various Motorola service manuals, but there's a much more comprehensive list at the Yannis Mott pages. These pages contain a huge amount of research into how Motorola phones work, and I'm really grateful. 58 hash shows the security code is still set to all zeros. 59 hash, that's the lock code, it's 1234. Okay, I'll see if I can do an LCD test. 99 hash, that just shows the startup logo. 99.1 hash. Test mode is interesting. We can do more emulating the clone mode of the transfer card. This gives you access to a lot more of the memory contents of the phone. There we go, we're in clone mode. The first thing I'm going to do is make a backup of all the memory contents of the phone that I'm able to. And I'm going to keep these safe as I start to modify the phone. I'm now going to switch to some different software called Medit, also available on the Yannis Mott pages. Using this software, I can extract all the menu items into a text file. Many of these have a 1 beside them, indicating that they're currently enabled in the phone. But the ones with a 0 beside them are currently hidden menu items. It's just a matter of editing this text file and putting a 1 beside the hidden menu items that I want to restore. I'm also using Medit to extract the wake-up graphics. This is a simple 96 by 32-bit pixel image that Medit saves as a bitmap file. This bitmap can be edited and it can then be patched back into the memory block using Medit. After doing all this, it's now time to load these modded memory blocks back into the phone. This is where things start to get a bit dicey, because some of the contents of these memory blocks include settings for the display and the keypad. There are also some memory locations which, if changed, can kill the entire phone and stop it from turning on again. And the only way to fix this is to use full Motorola service equipment, which obviously I don't have. But there's only one way to find out, and that's just to give it a go and try it. There we go. Okay, I'll get a proper SIM card to put in here. All right. Let's see that again, that power-up graphic. Well, that seems to have worked. I now have my own modified StarTAC. Engineering field options is now available. So let's have a look. Active cell. Well, of course, it's not on a network, so... Now, there's one more mod that I want to do with this StarTAC. It seems the hackers that contributed to the Yannis Mott pages found a flaw in Motorola's memory transfer system. They found if you put an FF byte into hex location 40 of the memory block, you would then be allowed to change a lot more of the memory contents than a normal Motorola transfer SIM would allow. And they found the memory location that would allow permanent access to test mode without a test SIM being required. And doing this also re-enables access to the keypad codes that I was trying earlier. And all of this was made possible thanks to that amazing work done in the 1990s with software such as ASIM by the Android. And while ASIM was mostly written for Motorola phone modding, it also uses the full cryptographic routines that SIM cards use to authenticate on the network. That means if you input your key or KI number into ASIM, you should be able to trick a network into allowing calls and messages to go through. And this should work on any phone, not just a Motorola. But that topic is outside the scope of this video. If you want to know more about how that might have been possible, check out the other video I've just released about that. And that brings us to the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed this one. Be sure to let me know what you think below. And don't forget all that YouTube stuff that can help this channel along. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.